What begattest thou? Or to the woman, what hast thou brought forth? Thus saith the Lord, the Holy One of Israel, and his Maker. Ask me of things to come concerning my son, and concerning the work of my hands, command ye me. I have made the earth, and I created man upon it. I, even my hands, have stretched out the heavens, and all their hosts have I commanded. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God stands forever. Grace and peace. The book of Isaiah, starting at chapter 8, verse 18. Chapter 45, verse 18 through 25. For thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God himself that formed the earth and made it. He hath established it. He created it not in vain. He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is none else. I have not spoken in secret in a dark place of the earth. I said not unto the seed of Jacob, seek ye me in vain. I, the Lord, speak righteousness. I declare things that are right. Assemble yourselves and come. Draw near together, ye that are escaped of the nations. They have no knowledge that set up the wood of their graven image and pray unto a God that cannot save. Tell ye and bring them near. Yea, let them take counsel together. Who hath declared this from ancient time? Who hath told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? And there is no God else beside me, a just God and a Savior. There is none beside me. Look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God, and there is none else. I have sworn by myself, the word is gone out of my mouth in righteousness, and shall not return, that unto me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear. Surely shall one say, in the Lord have I righteousness and strength. Even to him that shall men come, and all that are incensed against him shall be ashamed. In the Lord shall all the seed of Israel be justified and shall glory. I have read the book of Isaiah, chapter 45. Verses 18 through 25. Again, chapter 45 in the book of Isaiah, starting at verse 18. For thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God himself that formed the earth and made it. He hath established it. He created it not in vain. He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is none else. I have not spoken in secret in a dark place of the earth. I said not unto the seed of Jacob, seek ye me in vain. I, the Lord, speak righteousness. I declare things that are right. Assemble yourselves and come. Draw near together, ye that are escaped of the nations. They no knowledge that set up the wood of their graven image and pray unto a God that cannot save? Tell ye and bring them near. Yea, let them take counsel together who have declared this from ancient time. Who have told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? And there is no God else beside me, a just God and a Savior. There is none beside me. Look unto me, and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God, and there is none else. I have sworn by myself, the word is gone out of my mouth in righteousness, and shall not return, that unto me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear. Surely shall one say in the Lord, have I righteousness and strength? Even to him shall men come, and all that are incensed against him shall be ashamed. In the Lord shall all the seed of Israel be justified and shall glory. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
I greet you all in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the Living God. My Georgia and Sister Kamala have read so beautifully in our hearing the scripture from the book of Isaiah chapter 45, where God is stating out making us know of his sovereignty, that he is almighty. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He is almighty. And I like it when God says, I am the Lord. I am the Lord. And if he is the Lord and he is God, he is capable of doing anything. Hallelujah. God is capable of doing anything. God can become a stone. God can become anything he chooses to be because he's sovereign.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
And I don't see how that can become a bone of contention amongst those who reason with the carnal mind as opposed to looking at things spiritually. Over the past days, I've been hearing people saying that the New Testament actually is something that is concocted, and that everything in there, to the extent that they are saying that Jesus Christ never existed. And that's why the Word of God says that anybody who will say that Jesus never came in the flesh, he is Antichrist. God became flesh and dwelt amongst men. In the Old Testament, you see God. You hear God that you cannot see with your naked eyes. And yet he was encountered by prophets. He was encountered by the patriarchs. Abraham encountered God. Moses encountered God. The prophets of old had God speak to them, and they spoke. But in the New Testament, God took upon himself human flesh. God took upon himself human flesh. And I believe by now there are people in Ghana watching, and there are people in Nigeria watching, all in Africa and all over the whole world, people watching. And over here also, I believe there are many who are listening, who up to now are finding difficulty in understanding that God can become human and dwell among human beings. But exactly that is what happened. God took upon himself the form of man and came and dwelt amongst mankind. He experienced what you and I experience today. He was tried, he was tempted at all points, and never gave in to sin. When God came upon this earth, the name that he took upon himself is Jesus Christ. The Bible says his name shall be called Emmanuel. Yes. That means God amongst us, dwelling amongst us. And he shall save his people. Jesus Christ is his name. Yes, Jesus Christ lived upon this earth. And Jesus Christ is God incarnate. Jesus Christ is God becoming flesh and dwelling amongst men. That explains the deity of God, the sovereignty of God. That God can be a spirit, and the same God can become flesh and blood. When he died, that is when Jesus Christ was crucified at Calvary. It was God who was crucified, because Jesus Christ is God. And many have difficulty asking, believing why, if God were Jesus Christ, why would Jesus Christ pray to his Father God? But that is God. God can be whatever he wants to be. That is why he is God. And we are humans. Amen. And our minds, our brains cannot comprehend. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That is why to believe, to know God, you have to believe with your heart. If you seek to understand God with your mere mortal mind, you cannot. And that is why our world is wasting so much money, trillions of dollars, climbing into space to go and find where God lives, when God is very close. And he said, you can only know when you open up your hearts and receive him into your heart. Having explained this, let's go into the book of Isaiah 45 and see what God is saying. And we will start from where Mama Georgia began. Verse 5, he says, I am the Lord, and there is none else. There is no God beside me. Certainly, there is no God beside the God that we serve. There is no God besides him. And this I want the whole of Greensboro to know. I want the whole of Guilford County to know. And I want the whole of America to know, North Carolina to know, the world to know, that there is only one God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And that God is not Muhammad.
Amen.
That God is not Buddha.
Amen.
That God is not Rosicrucian. And that God certainly is not any human, not any superpower, not any president, not any chief. That God is none of those. That God, the God I'm talking about, is the living God.
Yes.
The God who became man and dwelt amongst men. His name is Jesus Christ. And some choose to call him Yahweh. Others call him Jehovah. But he said this in the book of Psalms, that I have exalted my word above all my names. And who is his word? Jesus Christ. The Bible says in the beginning was the word. The word was with God, and the word was God. Jesus Christ is the word. And he is God incarnate. Here he's saying that I gather thee though thou hast not known me, talking about Cyrus. That they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none beside me. I am the Lord and there is none else. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This God is awesome. He is a God who before the eyes of the whole of this neighborhood, when the clouds have gathered and it was threatening to rain, He stopped the rain before our eyes.
Amen.
He did not do it once,
Amen.
But many times.
Amen.
That is the God I'm talking about. And through Jesus Christ, we felt His face and He held back the rain. You've not heard any of the others who profess to be the other way to God do anything like that. Some use talisman. Others use rosary. But those are not the means to get to God. The only way to God is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I remember so vividly last year, August, when we have set up a stage right here.
Yeah.
When we were commemorating the release of our new album, it was very, very hot on that day. Suddenly it started gathering. And then the rain started pouring. And before our eyes, before every one of us, our eyes, when this man of God, a servant of God, stood before your eyes, right here, on the pulpit, on the platform, and called upon God, and in the name of Jesus Christ, He held back the rain. Suddenly the rain stopped.
Amen.
This didn't happen in a secret place.
No.
It happened before the eyes of the whole of the people on this East Coast Boulevard. And I believe, had the media been here, they would have documented that this thing did happen.
Yeah.
But yes, it happened because it was on our recordings. And before the eyes of those who came here, this is the God that I'm talking about. He is the God who became flesh and dwelt amongst us in the person of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He is the God who has become so little and has dwelt in the hearts of humans, who is able to take a murderer and transform him and make him into a saint.
Yes.
It is, His name is Jesus Christ. He did it then in the life of Paul, who once was called Saul.
Yes.
But He's doing it today.
Yes.
There are so many who are drunk, heavily addicted to drugs. Some who are murderers, who could not help, but they are always seething with anger, looking for the next blood to shed. But when they encountered this man, Jesus Christ, He has transformed their lives so much so that today they look back at their former life and they hate it with a perpetual hatred. Why? Because this God incarnate, this God man called Jesus Christ, whom they have believed in, has changed and transformed their lives. And they are no more the same as they used to be.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He says, I form the light and I create darkness. God is sovereign. He is capable of doing this thing. He is the one who formed the light and He is the one who creates darkness. God does it all. If God is not able to create darkness, then He ceases to be God. He says, I form light, I create darkness. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The God that I'm talking about, who sent His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die, who is God incarnate, that is Jesus Christ being God incarnate, He formed the light. The sun that you see above, He is the one who formed it.
Yep.
The moon that you see every day, or once a month,
Amen.
He is the one who formed it. The Bible tells us in the book of Genesis chapter 1, He formed two great lights, one to rule at night, one during the daytime. His name is God. He formed light and is the one who causes darkness to come. Soon it is going to be darkness and all of us will be going to sleep. It is God who has made it that way to give man rest. That is God. His name is God. His name is Jesus Christ. He makes peace and He creates evil. This is what God is saying. He spoke by His Spirit. I cannot change it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Modern translations have come and trying to, because there are people who are trying to say, no, God doesn't create evil. Well, that's what the prophet Isaiah is saying, that God is saying that I create evil. God says he is capable of doing that. We take him at his word. I, the Lord, do all these things. God is able to do all these things. If God is able to do evil or create evil, then you and I ought to fear him. Hallelujah. Because God is able, hallelujah, with the snap of his finger, to cause you and I to be swallowed up by the tiny stream that you may see, that you call creek. You will not even think that a creek can drown a human being. But God is able to cause a tiny creek to drown you and I. That is God. He is sovereign. He is able to do all things. There is no one greater than him. Satan is not powerful than God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now he says, drop down, ye heavens, from above, and let the skies pour down righteousness. Let the earth open and let them bring forth salvation, and let righteousness spring up together. I, the Lord, have created them all. I'm talking about God. Hallelujah. I'm talking about God, the creator of heaven and earth. I am talking about God, the creator of human beings. I'm talking about God, the one who created all things that you see on earth. The trees, the leaves on the trees, human hair, the earth that we walk upon, crude oil from which we extract gasoline, God formed it and put it underneath the ground, gold, diamond, he created all things. Just because you and I have discovered those things does not make you the creator of those things.
No.
Hallelujah. God created and put them all in. The very knowledge of being able to use, to refine the crude oil into gasoline that we put in our car, the knowledge of creating a car and using the gasoline in that car, all came from God. He created all things. Hallelujah. And so now God has come to a place and he's making a statement. He says, since he created all these things, woe. When God says woe, well, you better make sure you take it.
Amen.
It is so sad how humans who have become beneficiaries of God's abundant benevolence, we have become beneficiaries of God's generosity.
Yes.
It is so sad how we have turned against him and we have made ourselves look like we can do without him. We are enjoying everything that he has created and put upon this earth, and that we thumb our nose at him. We snarl in the face of God. We say out of arrogant pride that there is no God. God looks at it and laughs at us. God looks at it and will laugh at us. We say we are able to decide who dies and who lives. And just because we have weapons that we can kill humans, we think we are God and that there is no God. But God is saying tonight, woe unto him that strives with his maker. Woe unto him that strives with his maker. Woe unto him that strives with his maker. The moment you open your mouth and say, Jesus Christ is an imaginary thing, you are striving with your maker.
Yes.
The moment you open your mouth and say, there has never been anybody called Jesus, and that the New Testament was manufactured, you are striving with your maker. And God is saying, woe, 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 woe unto you. I wish persons like Nietzsche. Nietzsche used to be a philosopher, a great one at that, in Germany. This guy, out of arrogant pride, said that there was no God. On the day when he found himself become crazy, walking down the streets of Germany, this man was begging his doctor for an extended time. Well, he said there was no God. In his craziness, now he still reason for life. There are countless number of philosophers who have spoken out of their arrogant pride. And on their deathbed, when they began to see the images of hell, they wish they could have turned the clock around.
Yeah.
And there are so many also who are not philosophers. They are scientists. They are rich men who feel like their riches are more important than them coming to know the Lord Jesus Christ. So because of their wealth, they become so filled with pride. Not only rich, there are people who are poor. They are even poorer than the church mouse. And yet they also discount the very idea of God. Why? Because they are asking, if there is God, why am I poor? Why God didn't make you poor? God wants you to give your life to Him.
Yes.
If you find yourself poor, seek God.
Yes.
But you don't become angry at God and discount the very idea that there is God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Woe unto him that strives with his maker. Let the potsherds strive with the potsherds of the earth. Let the potsherds, let those ceramics, ceramic bowls, ceramic plates, let them strive with each other. But don't strive against the one who molded you into a ceramic plate, because when you do that, he will pick you up and drop you, and you'll be broken. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Let the potsherds strive with the potsherds of this earth. Shall the clay say to him that fashioneth it, what makest thou, or thy work? He hath no hands. This is where we are in great error. And where God is going to hold us. When he says war, he means war. A man created a man. God made you a man.
Amen.
And then you are saying God made a mistake. You should have been a woman.
Mm.
And so you go and change. You get a doctor, somebody with warped mind, who because of money, who stoop so low into accepting to change your gender from man to woman because of money. And then another person says, no, God made a mistake. I should have been a man, but I am a woman. And so you go and change from a woman to a man. And then you'll be suffering in silence. Because once you go through that transformation, suddenly you find out that you are in the wrong body.
Yeah.
And the reversal becomes very difficult.
Yes.
Woe unto the potsherd,
yes,
the strives of his maker, city of Greensboro, county of Guilford, state of North Carolina, the nation of America. We are striving with our maker. We are striving with our maker. We have declared God null and void. We have declared God a non-entity or non-existent. And once we are able to eliminate God from our thinking, we are able to do all that manner of evil. Man changing his gender into a woman, woman changing her gender into a man, man operating like a woman, woman operating like a man, man marrying man, woman marrying woman, And politicians sanctioning that. Politicians have become God, determining what God, what is right and what is wrong. Saying, God, stay away. You are not, I am the politician. I need their votes. Hallelujah. Well, there is a war. There is a day coming.
Yes.
There is a judgment coming.
Yes.
We shall give account of ourselves to the living God. We are going to give account. God means what he says. When God says war, he means war. I was reading the book of Ecclesiastes. And it's so interesting, chapter 11 and chapter 12. He said, go ahead, have all the pleasure, have all the fun you want to. Change your bodies and do all those things. But know that after all these things, God will bring you into judgment. You will give account to God. So know that in having all this fun, there is going to be a day when you'll be in darkness, and that darkness will be long. Death is coming one day. And once you and I die, we'll be in that utter darkness awaiting the judgment of God. And woe unto you if you died in your sin. Woe unto you if you died fighting against God. The Bible says again, woe unto him that strives with his maker. Our hands are too short to box with God.
Yes.
Our hands are too short to strive with God. Just because you have gone to medical school and you have learned some techniques in how to alter the human body, does not make you God.
Man.
And does not give you the license to condone things that are contrary to the will of God. When we can look at humans, a little baby in the human womb. Hello?
Yes.
When we can look at human beings, you put that machine on the belly and you feel a movement in the womb. And you can determine that there is a pregnancy and that thing inside there is not a toe. No, is that thing a frog? But it's a human being.
Yes. Yes.
And then you take knife.
Ooh, mercy.
And enter into the womb.
Mercy.
And slash that little baby who has done you nothing. In exchange for a dollar. You want money so you will murder. And when we call it murder, you say it's hatred. It's not hatred. It is the truth. It is a fact. You are committing murder, and that blood of that little child will cry out against you as long as you are alive. It will be haunting you in your sleep. It will be haunting you on your dinner table. It will be haunting you wherever you go until you repent and you turn from your wicked ways and you surrender your life to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Young girl, your body is a temple of the Spirit of the living God.
Yes.
Young girl, you are supposed to surrender your life to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You are not supposed to turn your body into a trash can for all kinds of men to enter into you. And then when the baby is developed, you go and expunge that baby. Woe unto him that saith unto his father, what begettest thou? Or to the woman, what has thou brought forth? Sadly, this is what is happening today in our world. It is not too far away from this city of Greensboro, where there are children who are confronting their parents. What have you begot? Your mom and daddy gave birth to a beautiful young girl. And then she gets up and says, Mama, why did you beget me a girl? I want to be a boy. And on and on and on. The Bible says, woe unto you. Thus saith the Lord, the Holy One of Israel and its maker. Ask me of things to come concerning my sons and concerning the work of my hands, command ye me. I have made the earth and created man upon it. It is God who made the earth. Hallelujah. The earth did not evolve. Hello?
Amen.
The earth did not evolve. It didn't come into existence by a big bang. No. The Bible says in the beginning, God made the heaven and the earth. It was created by someone, and that person is God, the living God. He created it. It did not evolve.
Amen.
Just because you have Darwin or all those guys or people, how can we? I mean, we believe humans more than the living God.
Lord.
Charles Darwin talked about evolution, and then he said, "Yeah, evolution." Somebody comes and talks about reincarnation. Yeah, reincarnation. We are so gullible that we buy into all these things that humans with their so feeble mind, have promulgated into a theory. And we bought into that. First, it was a hypothesis, and then it was a trial, and everybody said, yeah, it is true. When was the last time, please, anybody tell, that you saw a chimpanzee evolve to become a human being? The Ivoro Zoo is not too far away from here. Let the rich man in this world set aside $1 billion for one scientist to go and live in Ivoro Zoo for the rest of his life, monitoring all the chimpanzees. Watch and watch and watch for the one that becomes like a human being. That is a good scientific experiment. The chimpanzee is there, watch it. If it becomes a human being, we shall all change our mind.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
But you watch chimpanzee, born chimpanzee, die chimpanzee.
That's
gorilla, born gorilla, gorilla, die
that's
gorilla.
Right.
So where does evolution? Where is evolution? And this has been pumped into the mind of our sons and daughters. So that they will not believe the very existence and the reality of God. Hallelujah. God says, I have made the earth and created man upon it. I, even my hands, have stretched out the heavens, and all their hosts have I commanded. It is God who has spread these heavens above. It is God. We can't see him. But just the fact that we cannot see with our naked eyes does not eliminate his very presence. The very heavens testify of the fact that there is a supreme being. And that supreme being is bigger than the heavens. He has to be bigger than the heaven to make the heavens. And yet he becomes so small to dwell in the human heart. That is God. Hallelujah. City of Greensboro, County of Guilford, State of North Carolina, the nation of America, and the world at large, we will do well to humble ourselves. We will do well to humble ourselves. We will do well to repent from our arrogant pride,
yes,
our ego. We will do well to repent from all that, and turn our whole heart unto this living God. He will teach us what true life is. And here he says, in concluding, I'm coming to a conclusion. Verse 22. I love verse 19, because I spoke about the secrecy. He said, I have not spoken in secret. I have not spoken in a dark place of the earth. I said not unto the seed of Jacob, seek ye me in vain. No, he didn't say that in vain. I, the Lord, speak righteousness. I declare things that are what?
Right.
Everything that God has done, he has done it in the open, not in the secret. Hallelujah. When he created heaven and earth, he did it in the open. When he talked about Jacob, the blessings upon Israel, he didn't say it in vain, it came to pass. When he talks about the fact that for God so loved the world that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life, he said it in the open. And everyone who has believed on Jesus Christ has truly been saved. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So nothing that God has uttered was uttered in vain.
Amen.
So for those who doubt the very reality of Jesus Christ, the very proof or evidence of his reality is when you with your heart believe on him and with your mouth you confess. Romans chapter 10 verse 10. With the heart man believes, with the mouth he confesses that Jesus Christ is Lord, and he shall be what? Saved. That is the only way. With the mind you cannot comprehend it. We cannot believe with our mind. Hallelujah. We believe with what? Our hearts. And it has to be a sincere belief. And there will be a transformation. And soon you find yourself praising him rather than trying to oppose him. And now Jesus the Lord is saying in verse 22, look unto me and be ye what? Verse 22, look unto me and be ye
saved.
I want to hear everybody say, please, let's hear it and let it echo on the in the hearing of those who are listening to us. Look unto me and be ye what?
Saved.
Look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Not only the Jews, but the Gentiles. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Look unto me and be ye saved. For I am God, and there is none else. Just because he says, I am God, and there is none else, doesn't mean that Jesus Christ is not God. God in three persons. You and I are three in one. You have the soul, you have the spirit, and you have the flesh. Hallelujah. God. Hallelujah. It says, let's create man in our own image. Body, soul, and spirit. So God manifests himself as a soul, as a body, and as a spirit. He came in the flesh as a living soul. He died. He's gone. He's back in the spirit, in the power of the Holy Spirit. That is how he comes to live in your heart. That is how he transforms your life. That is how he shows you things to come.
Yes.
It is God in the spirit. Hallelujah.
Yes.
He said, look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth. For I am God and there is none else. You and I can be saved by believing on Jesus Christ as the Son of the living God. John chapter 1 verse 12. As many as believed on him, to them gave he power to become sons of the living God. Not Muhammad, not Buddha, none of those people. It is Jesus Christ and him crucified.
Yes.
We believe on Jesus Christ and we are saved.
Yes.
And God is saying, look unto me and be saved. And I like the last verse, 23, and then we'll close on that. I have sworn by myself, the word is gone out of my mouth in righteousness, and shall not return, that unto me every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. God has sworn by himself. And when God swears by himself, he means business. Hallelujah.
Amen.
When God swears by himself, he means business. That at the mention of the name of Jesus Christ, every knee should bow. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. City of Greensboro, County of Guilford, State of North Carolina, the nation of America, and the world at large, the continent of Africa, the nation of Ghana, the nation of Nigeria, the nation of Liberia, the nation of Sierra Leone, the nations all across the surface of the earth. Jesus Christ is Lord of all.
Amen.
He's the only one who gives us power. He's the only one who shed his blood at Calvary.
Amen.
He's the only one who was crucified.
Yes.
And he's the only one whom God recognizes.
Yes.
He's the only one whose blood, when God looks upon, he pardons your sins and he pardons my sins. Tonight, I introduce you to this man, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Those of you in Ghana who through arrogant pride are spewing out those kind of false doctrine that there is nobody like Jesus, that gentleman, I want you to do just one thing for me. Open your heart unto Jesus. Believe on him and he will save your soul. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ is saving today. All who run unto him, he says, Jesus Christ says, the Bible says in the book of John, chapter 14, verse 6, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. I believed on him. I trusted in him. And he has saved me. All those who are here tonight have believed on him, have trusted in him,
Amen.
And they've been saved.
Amen.
There are many cats across the oceans and continents who have also believed on him and have been saved. And I want to disabuse our minds of this one statement, which we hear amongst blacks. Some of us blacks on the African continent and in some of the continents of the whole earth, that Christianity is a white man's religion. My friend, it is not. Christianity is not a white man's religion. Are you all with